Welcome to Live at Three, and I won't lie to you, there is holiday fever gripping the show at the moment. And you know, it's only our 267th Live at Three.
Extraordinary altogether. Grace O'Shaughnessy has been touring around already in search of interesting fashions from stores outside the big cities.
And of course, they'll be modelled by four unsophisticated country lassies, more at home in the haggard and the hay shed. Do you believe that?
No, have a cold shower, Derek. Do yourself a favour. We also have a tasty enterprise item about a new line in Irish-made biscuits.
Gus Corrigan has part two of his little epic about preparing the family car for the holidays. And our astrologer is out again.
We've more inside information about the Eurovision Song Contest. But if it's music you want, you don't have to wait till Saturday night.
We have handsome husky Paul Duffy and cool, sophisticated debonair, or so he says, Mr. Tony Kenny.
Right, well, that's our lineup for today. In a moment, the weather prospects, but first, the latest news from Michael Murphy. Fold back.
A little bit of fold back, girls.
Fold back. Can you fold back?
The social security staff in the moment have staged a walkout because of an ILLA crest to workers at the dairy level. The INLA took action against people investigating
this way, right?
He's pretty liberal. Fine Gael is seeking a full-scale Boyle debate on the government's northern policy, following the Taoiseach's comments during his visit to the United States. The Progressive Democrats, Labour and the Workers' Party have all taken special notice questions on Mr. Haughey's comments. A 66-year-old retired stuntman from County Antrim has been charged with the murder of his female assistant. Emile Swan from Carneal Road, Carrickfergus, was charged with murdering Hilary Thompson, also of Carneal Road, at White Abbey Hospital last Sunday. The Special Criminal Court has fixed the 10th of May as the date for the trial of Claire O'Hare on a charge of kidnapping the Dublin dentist John O'Grady. That's the news for the moment. Back now to you, Thelma.
Thank you very much indeed, Michael. And now time for the latest weather prospects. Joining us today, the dreaded Charles Daly. Now, Charles,
hello.
What did you say yesterday?
I said it was going to be sunny, didn't
you
I?
You did.
Yeah. Well, I tell you what, I was the most disappointed person in the world when I woke
no,
up this
you weren't
morning.
Second most
looked
disappointed.
Out the window and I couldn't see anything except a few clouds. And
look
when
what
I got
happened
to the office,
my Gruig from the drizzle.
Yeah, well, at least it didn't freeze too hard. But when I got to the office, somebody said, "Do you know it's raining out there?" And that was even worse. But actually, the rain didn't last long. What
I
happened
believe
was
it was sunny in Rosslare.
It was, and down in Valencia, yes, they had quite a good morning, and I hope it's still shining down there too. But what happened was the atmosphere just got a bit more unstable. It had a tough night, you see, and it got a bit more unstable.
Right.
And as a result, we got a lot more clouds, which you can see there on the satellite picture, much more so than yesterday.
Actually, it is quite an extraordinary contrast of a picture to yesterday.
Yesterday was completely cloud-free. Yeah, except for a few up there on the northwest. Well, no, you know, we're being attacked in two different ways, but even so, I don't think it's going to be all that bad for the next day or so. For tonight, anyway, it'll be mostly cloudy again. It won't probably be that cold, much like last night. We probably might get a touch of frost where the cloud breaks.
Mm-hmm.
At this time of the year, if the clouds break up at night, I mean, you nearly always get frost. You
right.
probably know that. So
yes. But you did say last night that there would be a little fog too. So might we expect
fog,
a little fog tonight?
No, I don't think so. Not tonight. Well, if there is, it'll be very slight. The temperature's the lowest about 3 in the south and maybe a bit warmer up in the north.
But winds have actually shifted
very
right
light.
Around.
Well, they're very light at the moment. They're mostly from the northeast. The strongest wind we have at the moment is about 5 or 10 knots. You know,
okay, so nothing to write home about.
No, no.
And then what about prospects tomorrow night?
Tomorrow,
Charles, think carefully before
I
you
will,
say.
I will. Well, it won't be very sunny, I'll say that, right?
Okay.
We have to have a chance of a few showers, particularly in the north and east. And you might even get those tonight, I should have said that earlier. Won't be completely dry, but I don't think there'll be that much rain,
mm-hmm.
particularly in the Midlands and in the west.
But
so,
you're predicting a little more sun down in the south,
I think so, yeah.
East
they always
again
get it
tomorrow.
Down there, yeah. There, down in Rosslare, they might get a bit of sun, and down in Cork, down those places.
Okay.
But
our temperatures will be fairly respectable.
Yes, they have been today. Even now, at an hour ago, they were up to 13 or 14 degrees, which isn't bad for the time of the year. You
right.
Know?
Well, as you know yourself, temperature is really rising here in the studio.
Yes, I know
because
that, yeah.
You know what's coming next, Charles.
Yes,
Derek
yes,
is
yes.
beside himself with excitement here, and I know that you're going to enjoy our next item, which is fashion. So over to Derek.
I'm not beside myself, I'm beside Grace O'Shaughnessy, because indeed the next item is fashion. We said that Grace had been touring around the country. To what end, Grace?
To what end? Well, searching out lovely fashions, and we went to County Westmeath, Carlow, Roscommon and Tipperary.
The old car mustn't be going too well. I mean, you didn't get down into Munster or no, seriously up into the north or anything like that.
We might do that again sometime.
All right.
Yeah. But it was great fun.
Really?
Great fun.
Did you find anything interesting?
Found some lovely super clothes, and many of these shops actually have clientele from Dublin.
Oh, indeed, I know
all
shops
the way down
in Dunshaughlin and Dunboyne that have a places like that. Let's have a look at your first finding there now.
Well, our first finding was from Fashion Followers in Moat, County Westmeath, Derek. And that's just a super look. Fabulous, fabulous little suit. It's the bush style jacket. Mm-hmm. We can see it coming closer maybe now.
Yeah, the bush style jacket.
Yes.
Is this beastly out of Africa look still haunting
us? Yes, it is. It's still haunting us, actually, Derek. Yeah. Yes, it is. But it's, I love it. I think it's so classical and so simple and so beautifully styled. Mm. The whole thing, fabulous belt there and an all-round pleated skirt, as you can see now. It's a super look. It's in pure, pure silk. And I'm saying this because I'm going to tell you the price now.
Oh, come on,
it's
give us a laugh.
The fabric is super.
Come on.
£329 from Fashion Followers of Moat. And Margaret Claffey chose it for us.
Quick outburst of hysteria.
No, it's
£329.
It's gorgeous, Derek, and it's the last show today, isn't it, for a while?
Well, it's the last fashion show, I suppose.
We thought we'd go mad, yes, the last fashion show.
And you have gone mad, O'Shaughnessy, definitely. £329, all right, thank you, Olivia.
Super.
And that, who was
Fashion Followers of Moat.
Fashion Followers of Moat. Well, by the hooky, will you have a look at Anne-Marie Gannon? Just look
Isn't
at this.
Isn't it super? It's super. We found this in County Carlow, in Carlow Town, actually. Carlow Town.
In Carlow Town.
Bramley's, a lovely, lovely shop who specialise in beautiful evening wear. Indeed, they also do jewellery. And we found this.
When you mentioned the jewellery now,
yes.
She's wearing a very interesting piece of jewellery there.
And this is also from Bramley's of Carlow.
Ah.
They do terrific jewellery. You can see the gorgeous jacket embroidery en lace.
Uh-huh.
And I don't know if the camera can take up the little diamante, the little beaded, bejewelled.
Don't worry, Grace, even
the
if they can't, they'll enjoy looking for it.
Yes, there they will, I'm sure.
Yes, yes, indeed. Yes. The little, I can see the little triangle down there, yeah.
And it's the bodice of the dress is in elasticised, sort of ruching, smocking, really.
Elasticised smocking?
Yes, smocking, yes.
It's hanging on for grim life then.
So it is.
Right.
And the frilling around the dress just makes it a superb outfit. And this is reasonable.
Giving us all a bit of a frill, really.
Yes, yeah. £290.
£290. And where's
well
that
worth
from?
It. And this is from Bramley's in Carlow.
From Bramley's in Carlow.
And Dimple Bramley runs like the shop before. With her husband Patrick, and they do a great job. No,
right.
I haven't either.
Anne-Marie, thank you very
it.
Much indeed. You take your frills offside now. And Sheila is here.
And we're still with Bramley's this time. And just to show you that Bramley's can outfit the larger ladies too, they do up to sizes 18. Sheila, of course, wears a 16.
Am I right in thinking that that hat coordinates with the,
exactly.
with the rest of the
it was made especially, I think probably made especially for Live at 3, Derek, for you.
Ah, go on.
I wouldn't be a bit surprised if they had it done especially for you.
All right,
but
so there's
the
hat.
It's a terrific hat to coordinate with the top of the two-piece. It is a two-piece, in fact.
V-necked,
and we move down to a little rosette at the waistline.
Oh yes, if you look very carefully, you can see the little rosette.
Little rosette, it's lovely, isn't it? And a plain, solid navy skirt.
Plain skirt, then.
Yes, plain skirt.
Picking up the navy of the background of the rest of the outfit. Just price that little number for me.
Well, it's £195 for the two-piece. And that's not too bad, is it?
Did
and the hat,
the hat
is £50.
£50,
and that's from Dimna Bramley in Carlow, and they do the beautiful jewellery there. It's a
Many
super
thanks.
Shop.
Well, hello, sailor. Here is Laura.
First editions of Thurles and Clonmel was another place we visited, mm-hmm. and they have always been known for their super,
definitely,
super clothes.
Definitely
fabulous
a Matalo
look
to that hat.
Isn't it? The slight maritime hint, as we're always saying.
Indeed.
And this outfit is by Le Truc.
By
Le Truc. Le Truc. How's your
French, somebody
Derek?
Really, yes.
It's terrific. And you can see
blazer.
The gorgeous little hat. The blazer is very much the nautical look, as you said. It's £105. And Laura is now just going to take off the blazer. And you can see the smashing sweater
that's
underneath.
It's a very French-looking thing, isn't it?
It's beautiful. It's a real French look, the whole thing. Mary O'Donnell owns and runs the shops, and she does a great job there
of buying.
Where is that? This is from Thurles and Clonmel, first editions.
First editions, Thurles and Clonmel.
Thurles and Clonmel.
That's stylish stuff,
the little
all right.
skirt there is super as well. The cardigan is £109.
£109?
Yes, Derek. And the skirt is £75. You don't mind. It's lovely,
not
isn't
at all.
It?
No, 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 no. Laura, thank you
we'll
very much
indeed.
We'll
forget all about poverty just for today,
for God's
will
sake,
we?
Don't get any of that stuff dirty. We might have to pay for it. Right.
And another terrific shop, and this is from Marion's of Boyle in County Roscommon.
Right.
It's a super outfit here. It's just a great little piece of nonsense, as we always call this, and Olivia just looks stunning in it, as always.
Day at the Races,
and she looks
perhaps?
In anything.
The wedding?
Day at the Races, the wedding, anything, any special occasion.
Am I right in thinking that company also does big sizes?
They do, and that's the terrific thing about them. They do up to size 28, in fact.
You see, so young Tracy there has a lot of growing to do.
She does have a bit of growing to do. You can see the lovely draping as we move down the dress there. Yes. But they really are a terrific shop for that. They have a terrific, beautiful special occasion shop in Galway, as well as in Boyle, County Roscommon. So they do very well. Catherine McGee got this together for us today.
Did you price that one for us?
Yes, that's £118.75, and that's by Regine. And the hat is £21.
Yeah. Nice line of stuff in Regine, all right. Lovely. Okay, thank you, Olivia. I know it's Ms. Gannon back again.
Yes, again from First Editions. And isn't that a stunning colour, Derek?
Very, very cool.
Beautiful colour.
Now, you know, if you're watching our interior designer, he'd tell you that was a cool colour that moved away from
yes. All the shades of blue are meant to be cool. Yeah.
Anytime I've gone near the models, they've moved away from me.
I doubt it, Derek. You're only saying that. That's beautiful.
Lovely
I think that
hat
is lovely.
Picking up there.
The jacket, the deep lavender colour jacket. Interesting jacket, isn't it?
And the hat,
very,
perfect
compliment very pretty.
To it.
Perfect compliment. And in fact, if you'd like to take off the jacket, Anne-Marie, you can see the gorgeous little dress underneath. Mm-hmm. Unusual colourways there.
And of course, the pocket
there,
handkerchief
the
that we saw there
with the
was part
belt.
Of the fabric of the
it
dress.
It was
as well.
Fabric picking up the colour of the dress. It's a pure silk dress.
Oh wow! I just heard the cash register ring.
Yes. Mm-hmm. It's not too bad actually. It's quite good. The jacket is £159, I think, and the dress is. Would it be £175? This is from the Joby's.
You're
range.
Asking me, would it be
£175? Yeah, I know, it's a rhetorical question, sorry, Derek. Yeah, £175,
right.
And
Anne-Marie,
the hat is about £29.
Anne-Marie, take up thy handkerchief and walk.
And
thank
that's
you very
from Mary
much
and
indeed.
Dan O'Donnell's shop again, the First Editions of Thurles and Clonmel.
First Editions of Thurles. Now, Sheila back again. And this is the wedding look. This is the lady at the wedding.
It's lovely. It's lovely. It's a super hat to start off with. And this is from Marion's of Boyle again.
Let's just see that hat. Give us a turn there, Sheila. And the wee bow at the back.
The bow at the back. And Sheila wears hats very well. That's about £34.
Right.
And we're showing a very smart navy blazer.
Yeah,
navy always
plain.
Very fashionable, as we know. Very plain, but it's sort of part of any woman's wardrobe.
Sort
it would be a great addition to any woman's
thing,
wardrobe.
Right. And
terrific.
Underneath that, then, Sheila has a two-piece.
We have those lovely stripes, Derek. Horizontal or vertical, whichever you like. Whichever way you look at it. Yes, and you have a little green striping, green rope design down the side of the two-piece.
You're right. Going down there into the fully pleated skirt.
Fully all-round pleated skirt for ease of move. It's lovely. It's
just
a lovely
price
outfit.
That out for me.
That is £92 for the blazer. The two-piece, £181. Mm-hmm. The hat, £34. You're getting out your chequebook there, no?
No, just checking my pulse.
And again, remember, Marion's of Boyle, who up to size 28 for all the ladies around the country who want to look smart at a reasonable price and have something stylish as well.
Right.
So
I say
great.
Give the big man what
and
he
we
wants.
We just have
big
our last
right.
one now,
lovely.
I think.
Yeah. And Laura, oh, now that is...
Oh, Symphony in Pink, or a pink extravaganza. And this is from fashion followers of Moat again. Moat,
Fancy
with me.
That's a lovely outfit.
Isn't it beautiful? Now, do you love that, Derek?
I do.
I thought you'd love
and
that.
And what's wearing it?
I thought you might love what's wearing
to say,
it too.
Yes.
It really is just gorgeous, isn't it?
Yep.
Beautiful hat for which I don't have the price, but I don't need the price for the hat, do I?
Of course not.
It's a three-piece, and you can see the full effect of it now. It's just beautiful. It's an over jacket in this lovely filmy chiffon.
Is that a cami top or some sort?
It's actually a sort. It's not really a camisole top. It's a long line top. It's not really.
What's
the camisole really
the
would go only just
it
to
really
the waistline.
Look
it's beautiful. It's chiffon and a sort of satin. Peau de soie look to it. It's beautiful, isn't it? Peau de soie.
Peau de soie.
I'm going very Frenchy today.
Oh, well, merci de tout. Right,
it's
the price.
Eurovision.
Would you like
to
price that in francs first?
Yes,
then?
It's three... No, I couldn't do it in francs,
right,
but it's £300 punts.
£300.
Pounds, and Margaret Claffey got that together
need
for
to be
us
a
too.
Special
it's
occasion.
A super outfit. It is a special occasion.
Looks well
outfit.
With a suntan. I wonder
but
what
it's amazing
was.
Around the country, Derek. People do spend quite a lot of money on clothes, and they love quality.
Love quality, Laura.
They
thank you
quality.
Very much
thank
indeed.
Thank you very much, Laura.
And indeed, the appearance would be that a lot of those country shops now are going for very high class, very expensive
very,
garments,
very.
And not trying to compete with the cheaper multiples in the cities.
They don't need to. They have their own clientele, and they just have. They do awfully well, you know. And they pick out things for their special customers, and
oh, I have
people
been
rely on them.
Been
for
at
their
charity
taste.
Fashion shows around the country and been amazed, I must say, at the quality of the goods
quality.
There. Now, speaking of quality of goods, you thought you took the biscuit. He said, "Our enterprise
cute.
Item say really takes the biscuit, Thelma."
Thanks very much indeed. I think I must actually spend some of my holidays driving around the country to moat and places like that to see some of those clothing up close. Absolutely gorgeous. Well, just over 3 years ago, my next guest, Paul Kelly from Drogheda County Louth, decided to take a break from the farming business, something that he'd been involved in since his childhood, to set up his own enterprise, manufacturing high-quality Irish biscuits. And Paul Kelly, you're very welcome to Live at 3 today,
thank you very much,
and
Thelma.
Our enterprise spot. Now, from farming to bickies, that's a big jump. How did it come about?
Well, it's not really, when you consider that farming is in the business of food production, and with EEC quotas setting in and so on, I was looking for an area to develop, and there was a lot of talk at that time of value-added products and so on. So it's not really that much of a jump going from, say, flour or wheat to actually those products which actually use the flour and the
basic
wheat.
Ingredients.
Yeah.
Indeed.
So the biscuit thing came to life after a visit I made to Boston, and I got to like the American cookie, as they call it over there. But
is that a very big part of their daily intake, the cookies with the tea and that
very,
sort of thing?
It's very regular anyway,
yes.
As opposed to the shape. This is a distinction that I make between biscuits and cookies, where the biscuit is a regular shape, stamped out type of product, whereas my products, which are more cookie type.
More rustic,
yeah.
In other words,
yes.
Not absolutely even and smooth.
Yes, and this it's a weakness which I want to make into a strength of our little biscuit business, because we cannot make biscuits of exactly mirror images of each other. Mm-hmm. There's slight differences. They're just like you'd make them at home. So hence
so
we're including the word home style now.
Right, so based on a homemade cookie.
That's right.
That's what you're.
That's
so
right.
How did you go about it? You came back from Boston with all these ideas that you wanted to produce a similar type of cookie. On the Irish market.
Yes, well,
did you do some market research first?
I did a small amount of desk research, but my idea was that when I priced doing a really heavy metal kind of market research, that I could actually set up a factory for the same price as getting a really in-depth report done.
So what did you invest that money in
so
instead of
the
research?
So I spent
the
money on equipment rather than on paper.
Right.
So the next step after that was actually to produce some biscuits. And my first step in that was, I have to admit, the ingredients panels of competitors' type products,
right.
Which a friend of mine posted me from Boston.
Now, you were quite adamant not to have any colourings and additives and preservatives and things like that in the biscuits, no E numbers.
That's right. Well, it's something that everybody seems to be latching on to at the moment. I do say on my pack that we don't add any artificial additives. It depends on how you look on common salt, which we do use, and we also use standard home-style baking powder. But apart from that, we use absolutely no flavour enhancers or artificial colours or flavourings.
So you found yourselves then with your equipment, you'd started to make some biscuits. What sort of premises did you have then?
I'm afraid I jumped in at the deep end.
Did
and
you?
I got a 5,000 square foot factory, and the trick about it all was, though, that I couldn't afford to build or to buy an oven at the time, so I made my own oven.
Well,
so I made my own oven.
Well done.
And I sourced all the parts locally and so on. And it was quite a nightmare to get the machine to work properly because the biscuits in the centre were being done properly and the ones in the edges were not being done
properly. So trial and error before you got it all working.
Trial and terror, really.
Trial and terror, good one. Let's take a look then at the various biscuits. This one has a gorgeous little ingredient.
Yes, that's the lemon nut crunch, and that is a nice plain kind of biscuit with a little hazelnut and lemon oil added, and it's a lovely biscuit in the morning with a cup of coffee.
It sounds a lovely sort of sophisticated biscuit.
Yes.
Oatmeal raisin sounds nice and healthy, vitamin
yes.
C and the old fibre.
Well,
combined.
Oatmeal, I think, is coming back into vogue quite a bit. The raisin would be a good source of vitamin C,
yeah.
is right.
And your raisins are not whole, but they are actually pulverised
yeah,
and mixed in.
Minced, yes.
That's the correct word. Now, they're the sort of glossy packets. You actually do a more simple packet. This is a coconut cookie here.
We do. My idea there was to have our biscuits falling into two price ranges. The Kelly's branded products retail from 59 to 69p, whereas the simpler packed products, they're also it's also not quite as expensive a recipe. They retail from 39 to 45.
Right.
And I just wanted to have a little bit of exposure in the two segments of the market.
I see you're trying to knock the Scots
well, I don't see
off
why
the shelves here with the Irish shortbread.
I don't see why Scotland should have a world monopoly on shortbread, mm-hmm. and I'm not saying mine is a world beater at this stage, but we're working at the moment.
Good and, for you. And again, more simple little
butter rings. If you look at the butter rings, they would remind you of Christmas time, because it's funny, at Christmas, all the shelves seem to fill up with Danish butter cookies. The shapes of these butter rings is exactly the same as what you'd find in a tin of Danish butter cookies. So
really? And I see real chocolate chip.
Real chocolate chip, yes. Well, there's a trick involved there. When we started to produce that product initially, the chocolate we found was carbonizing. It was burning up, and we could only get away with not real chocolate chips. But in fact, we have since discovered a secret which allows us to...
Well, we're not going to ask you to reveal your secrets.
Yes.
I know at this stage you have you're employing 14 people.
That's right, yeah.
You're steadily gaining on the market.
Yes.
Your products are all the time improving, and you've even started exporting to the States.
Yes.
So it's definitely an enterprise that's going somewhere, and anybody out there who would like to stock your biscuits who hasn't stocked them already, I'm going to give the address now, but I must congratulate you, Paul.
Well,
and
one final thing I'd like to say, if you wouldn't mind.
In 5 seconds.
Our logo will be changing slightly, well, quite in a big way over the next couple of months. So when people see a change from this type of logo
to that on the screen.
Yes, don't be too surprised.
No,
the
so the
people.
Harp there in the K, nice
yeah,
work.
Cows,
okay,
yeah, yeah.
Let me give you the address for any further information on today's enterprise. Just contact Kelly's Biscuits Limited, Unit 4, and is that Clonshock?
Clonshock,
Industrial
yes.
Estate, and that's Dublin 17. Right, and from today's enterprise, it's back now to Derek.
And I promise you, my dear wife, I will not let one of them bickies pass my lips today. Anyway, do you know, since Live at 3 came back on air last October, we've probably engaged more than 200 musical acts, but we've missed one up until today, and that's Paul Duffy and his band. Now, they've joined us just before they head off to the sunshine of Ibiza to entertain the holidaymakers for 5 months. Lord, it's a hard life. Anyway, Paul's band and himself, they've been playing together now for just about 5 months. They're writing their own material, and we think they can look forward to a very bright future. So, will you welcome Paul Duffy and his band and The Pace of Life.
Some people live their lives you to get to the end of the line. Oh, the pace of life. Talking about the pace of life. Everybody's trying so desperately to keep up in the pace of life. Just what it's like to let it all hang out. People rushing around as if every day was their last. To be a mother mind, not to worry about a thing. Cause don't you know that everything works itself out in the end? Yes, it does. Just what it's like to let it all hang out. People rushing around as if every day was their last. To be a mother mind, not to worry about a thing. Cause don't you know that everything works itself out in the end. I want to tell you about the pace of life. Talking about the pace of life. Everybody's trying so desperately to keep up with the pace of life. I want to tell you about the pace of life. Talking about the pace of life. Everybody's trying so desperately to keep up with the pace of life.
Come on down, the price is right. Go on, Duffy. You're on live at 3 now. Listen, nicely done. And as I say, Paul, a very experienced performer with very good musicians around him now. Now, as we said, Paul and his band are heading off on Saturday. But before that, they're playing a farewell gig in, as appropriately enough, the Itchy Feet Pub in Terenure on Friday night. The band will be in holiday mood and I'm sure there will be the best of crack. So bon voyage, gentlemen. Now, coming up in part two, because we're going to take a wee break, but only for a moment or two, we have a song from Mr. Tony Kinney. We've got Motor Maintenance with Gus. That's part two of getting the motor ready for the holidays. We have got, we've got the inside track on the Eurovision. You might be interested to have a few wee details on that. All that and bags more. Join us in one moment for part two of Live at Three. See you then.
And you're very welcome back to part two of Live at Three. Well, continuing in holiday mood this Tuesday, following on last Tuesday's programme, Gus Corrigan, our motoring expert, is going to continue preparing and kitting out the car for the continental holiday. Gus, you're very welcome indeed. And what are you doing there? It looks like you're painting iodine on the light.
Thanks very much, Thelma. What I'm actually doing is I'm putting an amber masking on the light in preparation for driving on the continent, in particular in France.
Is this one of the legal requirements?
It's one of the legal requirements, and in fact they will not actually allow you into the country unless you have your lights to meet the legal requirement over there. And this is one of the legal requirements, that the actual headlamp prisms or the glass themselves are in fact masked.
Right, so you don't actually have to replace
it's a simple glass. Little headlamp yellow, they actually call it. It's available in most accessory shops, and you just simply brush it on. And in fact, you could bring the little bottle with you as well, with the brush, because you'll find that from time to time, if you're unfortunate to get very heavy driving rain, it will in fact
wash it off.
Slightly.
I see.
Yes.
So bring the little bottle
and
with you.
You'll have to top it off now and again.
Right. Now, there is another legal requirement with regards to the lights.
Well, obviously, in our country, because we drive on the, or we should drive on the left-hand side of the road, that the headlights, in fact, when in the dipped position, dip to the near side or to the left-hand side or to the curb side. And obviously in France, being the opposite, they will dip to the opposite side of the road. So what we have to do is we have to find some way of actually directing that dipped headlight to the right-hand side. Now, it would be nice if everybody had a spare set of headlamp units that they could actually interchange them. But obviously that expense would not be on. So what we have, a simple thing here actually, it's a little masking device, and they're available for all types of motor cars. And what in fact it is you just cut out the little segment to suit your motor car. On the back of this, there is a form, in fact, depicting which motor cars and which shape actually suits your car. And when you cut it out, you simply place it on the slot in the headlamp unit itself, on the prism here itself, just in that shape. And what actually happens is when the light passes through the prism of the headlamp, it deflects, the mask actually deflects that light to the right-hand side when undipped. And that's all there is to it.
Good. And is that little masking thing or deflective thing available?
Available in almost all good accessory shops, or certainly, the AA, the Automobile Association, would in fact have them, and have got them for all makes of cars. I've checked on that yesterday.
Right. So that's a very inexpensive.
Yes, and it's a must that you have it.
That
it's a must system. That you have it. You cannot travel without it.
You also need legally. To carry one of these triangles.
You cannot enter into France, indeed, or indeed Belgium or Germany without a triangle, and it rightly so, in fact, that if you're driving on the autobahns or some of the motorways over there and you're unfortunate enough to have a breakdown, you must have a proper regulation-sized, and that's the new regulation-sized, triangle. And it must actually have a device that it can be mounted on in such a way that the wind or the breeze are passing.
Right, it must have some way of weighting it.
Correct. Mm-hmm. And this one here actually has very, very heavy, strong metal bars on the bottom of it to, in fact, hold it very solid on the ground.
So it won't blow down.
Yes. And I'd emphasise that point again, that it's a regulation size, that it's very important that it's regulation size. There are little ones available on the market, and really, I won't say you'd be nearly better off without it. You wouldn't be nearly better off without it, but at the same time, to have the correct
one. But if you're going for it, go for the right one.
Correct.
And to mention that, motor accessory shop will help you in that. or your motor manufacturer.
And I think it's important to actually mention that to people, that you want the regulation size, in fact, the correct regulation size available.
Now, you have a lot of things here on the bonnet of the car, Gus, and I think we've referred to this in the past as the touring kit, but can you just refresh our memories as to what should go into this kit?
Well, literally, we could almost take another car on tow and still, unfortunately, not end up with the right piece if we had a breakdown. But I think, reflecting back on last week's programme, if we remember that we recommend that you have a proper 12,000 mile or whatever major service before you actually go on your holiday, and go to the manufacturing agents, excuse me, of your motor car, and have it carried out professionally. I mean, that's number one. It must be done professionally. And any requirements that they make for the long journey, have them carried out. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you don't, you're only asking for trouble yourself.
But this touring kit now consists of spares.
Yes.
Inexpensive spares, but spares that could take you out of a hell of a lot of trouble.
And spares that I would hope that our viewers, particularly on Live at 3, would be aware of how to fit at this stage.
Yes.
And actually, simple. If they've been paying close attention, simple maintenance. The number one thing, of course, is the fan belt. If you're unfortunate enough for the fan belt to fail, to actually have a replacement fan belt, and to make sure again that you get it from the manufacturing agents of your motor car, to make sure there's the correct fan belt to suit the requirements for your particular motor car. The next thing I would recommend that you bring with you, in fact, is a bulb kit. Now, that's a nice little bulb kit that's available. And that bulb kit, in fact, houses all of the bulbs requirements for your motor car. In fact, in the middle here, you have the halogen headlamp bulb. And here you have a side light, stop and tail light, and indeed an indicator flasher bulb also. And there's a little. This particular little kit, in fact, has a few spare fuses for the motor car for which it's belonged to here.
Kit, a handy
it's a neat
one.
Little kit, and it's again,
It's available for a particular make of car, but you can also have actually a multi-unit, which is actually available for right across the board in all types of cars. And again, this is another type with all the bulbs actually supplied within it.
Now, I see you've got some fuses there separately, but you also have a piece of hose pipe.
Yes, I have fuses, and I think it's important, actually. This is a nice little fuse kit, because right in the middle of it, I think if we can show it there, it has a little chromed fuse there, and that little one there is for the radio, and it's an awful thing if your radio actually fails. So that's just the complete fuse kit. A water hose, you can bring a complete set of water hoses with you if you want to, but really before you go, the water hoses should be in perfect order. Again, if you want to bring a top and bottom water hose, by all means, feel free to do so.
And I have here a little roll of masking tape that you mended many an old crack in a hose there for us over the weeks. And you would say, don't go without one of these.
I would thoroughly recommend that. It's the number one thing that you keep in the car, the PVC tape, actually.
Can I just pick out something that I think is essential to a set of spare keys?
I think there's nothing worse than actually finding yourself on a holiday and all of a sudden you've lost the keys of the car.
Yes.
So I think that whatever spouse
organize
is not driving
that.
A spare set
and of
course keys.
The first aid kit.
First aid kit is absolutely essential, and again, as we were just mentioning earlier on today, you mentioned very rightly, so to check to make sure that the first aid kit in fact has the correct requirements within it. It's a very, very cheap thing. Hopefully you will not be unfortunate enough to have to use it, but at the same time, particularly if you have children with you, it's an important thing to have in
there's
the car.
Also windscreen washer liquid, the damp start, a good safe petrol container, all of those sorts of things. But one can actually go to the garage, to the motor, whoever you bought your car from, and get them to give you a touring kit, and anything that you don't use, you can get your money back on.
Certainly, if you've established a relationship with your garage, you will find in point of fact that they will be too willing to supply you with a touring kit and in fact take it back when you come back from your holiday.
We must get on to the important thing of motor insurance. Gus, it is possible to get 5-star motor insurance for your continental holiday.
Yes, I don't believe that anybody should really travel on the continent without the correct insurance, and the AA actually offer 5-star insurance.
Just for 40-something pounds?
£45 plus £12 supplementary if you haven't got membership of the AA. And what that actually does for you, the simple way to explain it, is from home to home. In other words, if your car is unfortunate to calve on holidays, it will be returned back to your doorstep.
Total cover. Bail bond also available through the AA. That's if you're going to Spain. They tend to put you into jail for anything, any car accident. This costs £12. Mercedes-Benz also do this kit if you have an accident. It was the only kit that we could find that contains all the bits and pieces, the camera, flash bulbs, film,
super
tapes,
idea.
All the markers.
And all the correct relative forms as well necessary.
Indeed. This costs
£35 to £40.
Right, okay. So there's so many things available. We've had to dash through it here, but we've covered and hinted on the important things. But Gus, I have got to thank you sincerely for all your hard work and helping us all to become wonderful motor mechanics over the last 7 months, and added to our happy motoring. And have a nice summer.
Thank you, Sam.
And now it's time to join Derek with our next guest.
Well, first things first, I should tell you, Paul Duffy is in the Itchy Feet Club on Thursday, and not, as I said, Friday. But Tony Kenny is in here today, and just exactly as we said. You're very welcome.
Thank you very much, Derek. Nice to be back again.
Everybody's wearing a suntan. Everybody who comes into this studio is looking fit and tanned. I mean, what? Why? I mean, have you jaundice or a sunbed or
no,
what?
I've been on a concert tour in the United States with Noel Healy here, who is the musical director in Jury's Cabaret. And we did a 7-week concert tour in the United States, and we finished it with 1 week on a cruise liner, which went from San Diego to Mexico. And the weather was absolutely glorious, and we couldn't stop thinking about you.
Do you know, I find that very consoling. Am I right in thinking that you were down around the Cabos, down around the Mexican capes where they have all the tuna and marlin?
Fantastic down there. We saw one marlin they'd caught that day was 400 pounds.
Should have thrown it back, undersized. Yes, yes. All right, I mean, you mentioned Jury's Cabaret and the amazingly nimble and dexterous digits of little Noel there. I take it that this heralds the resumption then of business as usual down there?
Next Monday, we start off again for another 6-month season, and we're all looking forward to
it. Hal going to be there?
I hope so, yeah. I think Hal is home now. Hal was in the United States also.
It's a great life. You know, you can sort of split your time between the Irish summer and, you know, spending your winters then cruising around Mexico.
But what about all the hard work, Derek?
No, well, there's that too, yes. Well, it was good of you to leave that to us. Anyway, what are you going to sing for us?
I'm going to sing a song from a musical called Cats. I think one of the great modern songs, Memory.
Memory, all right. Mr. Healy, take it away. Mr. Kenny.
Thank you.
Not a sound from the pavement. Has the moon lost her memory? She is smiling alone in the lamplight. The withered leaves collect at my feet, and the wind begins to. Smile at the old days. Life was beautiful then. I remember the time I knew what happiness was. Let the memory live again. Every street lamp seems to beat a fatalistic warning. Someone mutters and a street lamp gutters, and soon it will be morning. Daylight, I must wait for the sunrise. I must think of the new life, and I mustn't give in. When the dawn comes, tonight will be a memory too, and the new day will begin. The stale cold smell of morning. A street lamp dies, another night is over, another day is dawning. Touch me, it's so. If you touch me, you'll understand what happiness is. Look, a new day has begun.
Fantastic performer altogether. Well, folks, you know, it's a sure sign that summer is almost on top of us when we hear that Tony Kenny begins the Jury's Cabaret on Monday night next, and that runs for 6 months. So you have 6 months. So you have no excuse whatsoever for not getting down along to see the man himself in action. And thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Helen.
Absolutely wonderful to have you on the show. And you know what? It's a sure sign it's Tuesday when astrologer Una Rogan is sitting beside me on the pink settee. You're very welcome, Una.
Thanks, Helen.
Now, the dreaded full moon is around again.
Yes, it is. And the dreaded full moon this week is a dreaded full moon. Mm-hmm. So I think we'd be better all just going to bed on Sunday night and forgetting all about it and waking up nice and bright on Monday morning.
So
morning.
So it's Sunday night, Monday morning
right.
that it happens.
Right.
So be prepared if people start to fight and
yeah, it's
things
a very emotional
wrong.
Full moon, so
Do
it's
know,
best to avoid it.
We have some wonderful birthdays this week. And yeah? one is the big one for the big man himself, Derek. Happy birthday,
Happy
Derek,
birthday, Derek.
Today.
Thank you.
And you don't look it at all.
I feel it, I have to tell you, I feel it.
It was the children gave you that badge
yes,
this
yes,
morning.
Yes, yes, indeed, yes. Look at that, isn't that dreadful?
You shouldn't be hiding it.
Yeah, it's more like my weight than my age.
Una, is it going to be a good year for him? What
it's actually
see?
Going to be a very good year for Derek. He's starting a whole new cycle. And in actual fact, Derek, that if you've got a book inside your head, this is the year to write it. You know, really get down to doing some writing. Oh. Also a year of travel. Quite a lot of opportunity.
Well, I
but
know
he's
he'll
starting
be
a new cycle.
Yeah.
And it's going to go on for the next 2-3 years. So
good.
He's into good times.
So I have a 2-3 year cycle of Derek, have I?
He's going to be in good form.
But it'll be a good
well.
Cycle. Good, that's what we want.
Right.
Now listen, Jump the Gun, of course, are representing us in the Eurovision on Saturday.
Right.
And the composer of the song is Peter Eaves. Now, how do you reckon, his birthday was yesterday, he was
that's
32.
Right.
How do you reckon his chances?
Again, he's starting a whole new cycle in his life. Now, his chances on Saturday should be very good. You know, things are looking very good for him. But more importantly, it's going to get better for him as time goes on.
So it's not just going to be a one-night
no.
success. He'll have success right throughout
right
the next
through
couple
the
of
next
years.
The next few years.
Isn't
like
that
there,
marvelous?
Yeah.
What about the rest of us poor divils? Can we start by the rundown of the signs, starting with the air signs?
Well, OK. Now, for you, Gemini, this week you're building up some emotional upset. So the best thing to do is get a good relaxation technique or do some reading or go out to the theatre, that kind of thing, just to help you relax a little bit. And for Libra, financial backing seems to be an issue at the moment. Don't make any assumptions, just go discuss things very carefully before making any commitments. And for Aquarius, don't be dogmatic at home, because there's a very sensitive family matter that needs very careful handling, so deal with it sympathetically.
And the water signs?
Water signs, well, for Cancer, you're very busy this week, a lot of entertaining, but there's a long overdue dental appointment that you need to put off no longer. And for Scorpio, compromise in relationships, just give your partner a little bit of space and let him do some talking, he needs that. And for Pisces, you need to be with people this week, so any invitation that comes your way, take it.
And the fire signs?
Fire signs. For Aries, a lot of hard work and perseverance is now paying off, and in the next couple of weeks, money is going to be much better. And for Leo, well, you have a chance this week to make a very big impression and a lasting one, so make sure that it's a good one. And for Sagittarius, if anyone is trying to push you into a commitment, don't despair, because your intuition, in actual fact, will be the best guidance you can get.
And finally, the earth signs.
And for Taurus this week, very eventful week, a little bit of stress around. So the best thing to do is put on your dancing shoes, get out there and enjoy yourself. And for Virgo, if you're planning a trip, well, it's a very good time to do it, but do allow some time for relaxation and, you know, make a relaxed schedule. And finally, for Capricorn, plenty of look around Capricorn. Don't mind the setbacks at the moment. They're only minor. So just go out and have some fun.
Una, thank you very much
thank
indeed
you.
For all your hard work over the last few weeks. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
Have a lovely summer.
You too.
Derek, you've got the news of the Eurovision for us.
Indeed, 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 indeed I have. I wish I could believe all that. Thanks for the nice sentiments anyway. Una, I still think you're committable, but no, I'm not here to that. Yes, if we turn our lights down ever so slightly, can we bring our lights down a little bit in the studio, can we? Just ever so slightly. See them coming down nicely? See they're just coming down nicely, right? The reason is because standing over there is Alan Pless, who's the director of design, the head of design in RTE. And in between us is something you have not seen before. It is the Eurovision set. As you probably know, you probably didn't know, in fact, that it's been completely miniaturised, and in fact Pat Kenny has recently shrunk to an inch and a half, and it's all done with it. This is a scale model of the set. And Alan, you're very welcome to the studio.
Thanks, Derek.
It's a pretty impressive looking enterprise, isn't it?
Yeah, the whole thing is an enterprise, I think. It really started for us about 12 months ago when we knew we had to mount it again. We'd won the contest, and we started planning 12 months ago for this whole competition. So there were initially two production designers put on this, because obviously the heart of the whole production is the set, which about 400 million people around the world will look at this set for about 3 hours.
Now, let us state again, this set was designed by whom?
Designed initially by Michael Grogan, who is a senior production designer.
Who's done the Eurovision before.
He actually did it in 1981. And Paula Farrell, who at that stage was a young assistant, and she is a full designer now.
Who came up with the wee logo?
Oh yes, the logo was, we held a competition around about September because we wanted a very impressive and smart logo for Eurovision, which we could use not only for the graphics on the production, but also for styling for many other reasons, commercially as well, of course. And Maria Quigley, who was one of our young designers in graphics, she won this competition and we've used it extensively since then.
All right, so we have our set, we have our logos, we have colour schemes and all the rest of it. We've got, I think, 21 lighting changes or something like that during the course of the
That's right.
of the thing. Just explain to me, on either side of the set here, I can see what look like cassette boxes. I mean, but these are going to be huge. These are huge screens of some sort.
Yes, they're called video walls, and they're made up of individual projection screens. They're about, each one is about the size of a double-decker bus, to give you some idea of the scale of the operation.
And that's, there it is there, you can see the scale model of it. The real one, as you say, the size of a double-decker.
Exactly.
And there are going to be two of those.
Two of those, yes. And obviously this is a first in many ways. First time these video walls have been used. The first time there's been so much technology put into a Eurovision design. Because what we found in the last few years, since 1981, the technological change has been so great that people, young people, are watching videos 24 hours of the day on other channels maybe, which are costing thousands and hundreds of thousands of pounds to make.
A relatively young executive in overall charge of the production, a young director, young designers I know involved in it too, Alan, with the greatest respect to yourself. Can you give us some idea? Now, presumably where that little figure is standing there is where the principal singing will take place.
Yes, well, if there is a single singer, that's where the position would be on the set, of course. There will be groups containing many more than just a single performer. And in fact, that means that we have to provide services for groups of anything up to 10 people, maybe grand pianos and so on.
Bung the lid on it there, and we'll just try and
get
it.
Yeah, sure.
I have not tried to do this before. Oh, Lord, will there be some crack now if I bring down the Eurovision set? It'll never work again, they said. They're probably right. There it is, and you can get some idea of the lovely depth of colour in there if we come in on that. You see that? Lovely glowing blues and reds. A lot of black on the set too.
Yes, because obviously it's going to set off the whole of the technology using black. Incidentally, we've used about 5,000 metres of neon in the floor and the ceiling of this whole enterprise. The biggest operation of neon outside America ever.
By the hokey. Let us have a look at what they are competing for.
Oh yes, indeed. This is actually a trophy which is given to the winning composer. I'll handle it carefully because it's actually in three parts, Derek. And I'll take the top part off so I can show you. It's engraved. It's sterling silver.
Right.
And it was presented to us, incidentally, by the Retail Jewellers of Ireland.
Well, they're old friends of ours because, in fact, they've been very good to our wedding competition. They provided wedding rings and things like that. Very, very expert people.
Yes.
And they have produced, that's the top part of it.
Yes.
There's a glass dome with the Euro logo on it.
That's right.
And then just let's have a look at part two of the thing, which is the plain bowl. Sorry. That's the one that they can put, they want to get a full bottle of champagne into that. But they certainly have a sup out of it. Am I right in thinking that that is sort of 4,000-year-old bog oak?
Indeed it is. A 4,000-year-old piece of bog oak specially turned from Mr. Hyde of Ockham.
All right.
And that is presented and is worth a lot of money. As you can see, it's specially hallmarked, and it has the Dublin Millennium hallmark, which makes it even more unique.
Well, Alan Pless, you are the man who ultimately carries the can for this, whether it goes right or wrong, and I have to say I've got a great deal of confidence because I don't think I have ever seen as much design effort go into an RTE set.
Thank you, Derek. Thank you very much.
And congratulations to you and your very talented team of people. We know it's going to be a cracking night. because Ireland and RTE will be putting their best foot forward. And I know Thelma and I want to take this opportunity of wishing Pat and Michelle the very best of luck on the big night. Now,
absolutely, Thelma. Absolutely, Derek. And it's Derek's accent there saying "plus," because we always call Malin "plice," you see. That's lovely little northern twang, Derek. Right, let's take a quick look then at the newspaper headlines, starting with the Belfast Telegraph. UDR man is shot dead in Tyrone. A UDR man who joined the regiment only a few weeks ago was shot dead outside Ardbeau in Tyrone today. Evening Echo headline, fake vodka haul at border. Another border story there. Customs officers in the north have made their first seizure of the rogue vodka, which caused a poison scare among drinkers on both sides of the border last year. Limerick Chronicle headline, GAA snub suspected by mayor. That's Fine Gael mayor Tim Leddon believes that the GAA had delayed the opening of the £1.5 million Mackey stand as a snub so that it would not take place during his term of office. In the Evening Herald, we see the headline is jailbreak in pyjamas. That's a robber jailed for 5 years who escaped this morning during the changing of the guards in the Mater Hospital. And in the Evening Press, several big stories here. Child of six has AIDS. That's the six-year-old child of an intravenous drug abuser, and that's full-blown AIDS. Father Malloy, the Cardinal O'Fee, is being asked to intervene. Dogfight blacklist. A list, the Gardaí have been given a list of the names of people involved in dogfighting along the border, and they're going to try and do something to stop that. Right, well, you try stopping me now, telling you about tomorrow's programme, because what a show we have lined up for you. More of the same like today coming your way. Our cookery experts, Matt and Brenda, will be lighting the charcoals for a little barbecue. Our sewing expert, Bernie, is working on beachwear. We'll have a top hairstylist in to show us the look for 88 this summer. And we look at Swedish Week. We'll also have the usual helping of music, this time from the very popular Northern act called Club Sound. And of course, top singing star Joe Dolan will be our special guest on the show tomorrow. All that and much more on Live at 3. See you then.